Hello everyone, Jennifer from Sun Dragon Cards here. Thank you for joining me today in creating through my Hoard. And I don't know if this is number two, maybe? Number two or three, I can't remember. Anyway, I am in the middle of going through a lot of my scrap papers and thought I'd make this little mini journal here. I just got the papers together and then I started making some of these little pictures to put in there, and I wanted to work with some of Ruby and Pearl's little kit called the Classic Beauty, which is, you know, a lot of these little bits of collage type photos. And this is from a different kit of Ruby and Pearl's, Heather from Ruby and Pearl. I'll go ahead and I'll put her link in the description. What I like to do a lot of times is I like to make these cards quite substantial to make them look like they are from, you know, back in the 30s, 40s when they had photos a lot thicker. And I thought I would go ahead and do that and show you how to do that today. So first off is I print off the kit onto photo paper, which I use this HP Premium Plus, and it is glossy, but it is extra thick. I think you can try matte if you don't like that shiny look. But a lot of times I choose the glossy because of I like to sometimes age this by when I sandpaper. You'll see what I do with a lot of the photo ones. But you can find this on Amazon. I have been fortunate to find a lot of photo paper in estate sales, and so far since I started junk journaling I have not bought any photo paper. I've always found them in estate sales, so I haven't paid full price, let's say. And when I go to estate sales I always grab a bunch of stuff and bundle everything and get a great deal that way. So what I like to use as backing, so I'll print these out onto the photo paper, and I like to use the type of cardstock. I think stacks is a type of, they come in a packet like this. And I like to use the ones with the white core. And the white core in the middle gives it that antique type of a look when you sandpaper it. And doesn't that look just, I just love that look. Nice and shabby. So what I do is I'll take one of these. Actually, let me see. I think maybe, don't know what, I'm not sure what color I'm gonna try first. I think the blue. I love this color blue. So, is there two on here? Yeah, okay, there's two on here. So I just use, sometimes I'll use the art glitter glue. Sometimes I use the Fabri-Tac. But I do use glue that is very, very sticky and reliable, so that when you do sand everything together, it doesn't come apart. And as you can see, it looks like it's just one piece. So the glue has to be really strong. Anyway, how's everyone doing? Hope everybody had a great Labor Day weekend. I had a great Labor Day weekend. Took my kids, my son and my sister-in-law, my son and my daughter-in-law and my grandkids all went to the beach, to the coast, Oregon coast. And it was just beautiful. It was a little crazy though, because you know, they have two dogs, we have two dogs, they have two kids, and you know, my husband and I are at that age where we're not used to little kids running around anymore. But it's a good thing we were outside in the coast and enjoying each other's company. And I love that. It was lots of fun. The weather was beautiful. This is the one thing I don't like about Fabri-Tac. It can be a little shiny, too shiny and sticky. So when it kind of goes all over, it can go onto your stuff too, your image, and it comes out shiny. And sometimes I don't like that. Sometimes I guess it doesn't matter depending on what you're doing. But in this, I really don't like how that came out like that. So let's go with this glitter glue, which, by the way, I saw Leslie from 507 Willow. Leslie from 507 Willow House, I think. She was having trouble with her art glitter glue drying and everything and turning out gunky. I found that when I use these instead of stick pins or regular sewing pins, I found that using this, these are from Tim Holtz. It's got a thicker, it's the width of this is a little bit thicker, so it fills the hole a little bit. I don't know if you can see that. It fills that tip. It kind of closes it more because it's a little bit thicker than a regular pin. And my glue comes out a little, it can come out like this, like part, I think it rusts the pin, but at least it doesn't get stuck. So I'm okay. And you know, you don't see the glue anyway. And it's, especially when you're going to stick things on and it'll be just right behind everything. So don't pay too much mind to that ugly color because we're not gonna see it anyway. But I do care about it flowing nicely. Let's see, I'm gonna just put it on here like this. And I have to be careful with wet wipes, because especially when you've printed onto photo paper, the wet wipe can smudge the ink. So a lot of times when I am trying to get, if you can hear scratching at the door, those are my dogs. I apologize for that. We just got a new Bernedoodle. He's 8 months old. The owner is a breeder and a friend of my husband's. And his name is Ollie, short for Oliver. And we got him for free, which is great. And because the owner already had, was going to end up having, I mean, she already had four, including Ollie. And she just decided she just couldn't keep four big old Bernedoodles around the house. So we have a standard poodle named Jackson, who is, let's see, he'll be 11 years old, I think. And, yeah, 11 years old. And I think was lonely. And we didn't even realize it because, gosh, he's just having so much fun with Oliver. And he's not I don't know, he can be a jerk sometimes. You know, when people come over, he's just barking away. And, you know, standard poodles are not known to be aggressive at all. And he really isn't aggressive unless you're behind the door or the doorbell rings. But once you come through the door, you're fine. You know, he's like so friendly and a little bit too friendly. But in any case, he's a really good dog, and he's been a very good dog, and I love standard poodles. And the Bernedoodle is just totally even though he's part poodle, the Bernese mountain dog in him is just so kick back. He's just so laid back, and he'll come and cuddle you and just lay his head, you know, on your shoulder. And he's just such a good dog. So cute. But right now he's in the puppy stage, and so he wants to be with me whenever I'm, you know, filming or anything like that, or trying to work in my craft room. And luckily, from what I understand, Bernedoodles are very social dogs, and they need to always have somebody, a companion around. And luckily my husband right now at this time is working at home, so he's always got my husband. But I think he's become a mama's boy. Because I work all day, but as soon as I get home, he is on me. He will not leave me alone, which is okay, which is fine. Okay, so let me try to get these stuck on there and dried a little bit, and we'll see how. This is a dry wet wipe. So, and I think the big problem too is my fingers. I'll get glue on my fingers, and I touch the image, and then before I know it, I have that stuck on me. But let me go ahead and cut this. Let's see. Go use these scissors. So I go ahead and I just cut as close as I can to the image. And you know, I had forgotten about this white core type of scrapbook paper. I used to use it a lot when I, you know, several years ago. I'm gonna try to straighten this. This is not, there we go. I think that's straighter. I used to use this back in my card making days. And I still make cards, but not to the extent of what I do with junk journaling. I mean, since I've discovered junk journaling for about a year now, I've kind of slacked off on my card making and really got into junk journaling. I think there's the difference between card making and junk journaling is that the card making, you kind of just give those away, which is fine, which is great. I mean, I love doing that too. But the junk journaling is the joy of trying to find things that you can implement in the journal. And what you feel a person would be interested in when they're writing in that book. I like to envision, put myself in that person's viewpoint when I make these books. Like this one coming up here, this little one. This is from Ruby and Pearl, this printable, but I put wax on it. And this is from Amity Bloom. This is her coin envelope kit. And then a lot of these are real real pages that I've collected. This here, this is, I just love this. This is kind of fun. Let me see. I just kind of made a corner pocket out of lace. And I thought, you know, that's great. Because, I mean, I have all these scraps of lace. And, you know, you can, there's only so many snippets and snippet rolls that you can make, you know, out of those scraps or little collage things. But when you come up with like little pockets like this from a little scrap, that's just so much fun. I just love that. And I love using up my scraps. So, you know, this here is a scrap. And anyway, this will be, once I'm done with this, I will do a flip through of this and have it available in my Etsy shop. But again, I love to put my thoughts into my journals by, I guess my experience into these journals by thinking of what I would do like on this page and what I would write about, what I would jot down, or what would inspire me when I look in this page and what I would want to write down or add or, you know, collage or anything like that. So that's what I like to do when I make these journals. And I think that's the difference between card making and junk journaling. And plus, you know, junk journaling is just so fun because you're using scraps. And I found that since I have gotten into junk journaling, I now implement that in my card making. So I make a lot of birthday cards, wedding cards, and you know, all kinds of different cards. And I find that I'm using all my stuff, my scraps, my pictures, everything in my cards too. So, which has been a lot of fun. So it's been quite an adventure and an evolution in my crafting. So what I do here is just I kind of make sure that when I use, see, and I don't know, this is a pretty thick sandpaper. I don't know what grid it is. I got this from my husband, his sander, and I asked him for some sandpaper, and this came from one of those built sandpapers, and I am so sorry. I don't know what the grit is on this, but any grit will do. I mean, of course, the more coarse, the more gentle you have to be. You want to be careful not to rip too much. But what I do is I kind of bend down like this and kind of mesh it into the image. So then it becomes like one piece. And there you go. And you just got to make sure too that when you do glue, the glue goes all the way to the edge. And so, and the reason for this white core cardstock is because when you do this, it gives that shabby look to it. Now you can kind of go cross grain like this and give it that look if you like, or you can just go one way and just continue doing it to the look that you want. There you go. And what I like to do is on some of them, depending on whether or not, like this one has a border already, this picture, I don't like to round the corners because I kind of like that look. But for things like this, I'll go ahead and round the corners. But let's see. Sometimes on some images, I will do a little sanding on the front to give it a more grungy look, a more tattered, I guess, look. And I can probably, let me see if I do it here. And I do it lightly. I don't do it that much, you know, because I want the image to still be intact. And you know, it is possible to go overboard, which I have done. I have gone overboard, but you know, I don't want to. I think that's enough before I go overboard. Don't want to do that. Okay, and there you go. That's one. Yours, I can go ahead and we can do, let's see, where are we on time? I'll do one more. Let's do the bigger one. What we can also do too is, I've done this as well, is just kind of do the tea dye, which I do love the tea dye, this distress oxide, Tim Holtz Ranger. A lot of people will use the, I don't have it out, but whatever's brown, the brown one. But I like the tea dye color only because it's a little bit more subtle aging. I don't like to go overboard. I like to have just a little light aging. Sometimes I don't even distress at all. I just leave it. And I do like that look more. And that's just my preference. I prefer not to have that. I think she got glue on her face. There. Oh, good. scared me. I thought I was gonna. Okay, there's that. And let's go on to this one. So again, I just kind of push up like this, up against the image. I'm taking my hand where the sand, so I'm left-handed. So you just take this and you just push up against while your underside, your other hand is pushing back up against the sand, the sanding part, the sandpaper. And then it kind of meshes when you're sanding downward up against the image, it kind of meshes the papers together. I hope I'm explaining this right. And then I just kind of do the other side just a little bit. Don't go too much because I want it to kind of blend together. And when you only do one side, then this side runs the risk of folding up. But if you're doing it both ways, then it seems to bond together. I'm trying to find the right word to that. But yeah, see, there's that edge. I think it works out really well. And the purpose of this, you know, I think it just makes it look a little bit more old world, I guess. You know, you see those older pictures, they're really thick. And they've got thick paper backing. I haven't tried writing on this, though, because this would be a nice backing for, you know, journal cards and stuff. So I'm not sure how it worked, how it would turn out. So let me, but I mean, it's smooth enough. Okay, let me see. I'm going to put my little JK on here. You can write really well on it. Yeah, that works really well. So there you go. My little tutorial, I guess. This was actually recommended by my good friend, my nice new friend, Karen. She got one of my journals and asked how I got one of the images so thick, and I wasn't really sure what she was talking about. I had to go back and look, and I thought that maybe it was just because of the thick paper, but it's actually, I do back it. I've backed a lot of this stuff. This technique with cardstock. Could be anything. It could be thicker if you want to, or it could be thinner, but that's how I did it. Karen, this is how I did it. And I hope that I was able to explain this to where you can understand it, because I told her that, no, I don't think I could do a tutorial. I can only probably do just, you know, flip-throughs. But as I was making this journal, I thought, you know how hard, I mean, all I have to do is just do it and explain what I'm doing as I go. And so, there you go. Hope you enjoyed this, and please like, subscribe, give me some comments. I would love some feedback. Thank you. Have a wonderful day. Bye-bye.